Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to MALDEF's 2024 Chicago Awards Gala.
MALDEF is grateful for the support of our national gala sponsors, Adobe, Verizon, our benefactor, Tallship Partners Fund, LLC, our patrons, Phil Fuentes, Instituto del Progreso Latino, our sponsors, the friends and family of Patricia Mendoza, the Illinois Association of Hispanic State Employees, the Illinois Judges Association, the Chicago Community Trust, the Hispanic Lawyers Association of Illinois, Minor, Barnhill, and Gallen PC, Cicero Law Group, the League of United Latin American Citizens, Mano a Mano Family Resource Center, the Chicago Teachers Union, Lawyers Lend a Hand to Youth,
MALDEF is pleased to present this short video from our national gala sponsor, Verizon.
I met William in the sixth grade. From the beginning, he wanted to explore things.
My first time witnessing the Verizon Innovative Learning Program, Mr. Gonzalez put a robot in my hand.
He could speak, but he still didn't have that confidence.
For the City of the Future project, we presented what we would want Compton to be like.
These are ideas that are coming from them.
We're not just like moving away from the community, but actually going in and helping the community.
We have hope.
Now is the time to think about the future.
Thank you, Verizon, for your ongoing financial support and for the courage to stand on the right side of justice for DACA. Damas y caballeros, please join me in welcoming MALDEF's President and General Counsel, Thomas A. Sines.
Good evening. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to MALDEF's 2024 Chicago Awards Gala. I am honored to play multiple roles for you this evening in recognition of the fact that so many Latinos and Latinas across the country daily play multiple important roles. Tonight I will be serving as your MC, as an earnest pitchman, and as President and General Counsel of MALDEF. So this may be confusing to some of you. To help to overcome that confusion, I will endeavor to keep my head down like this, so you only see my hair when I'm the MC. And looking at my hair, you can imagine that I'm actually Jorge Ramos, or Anderson Cooper, maybe Anthony Fauci, if that's what interests you, rather than having to imagine how much they're making me do tonight in playing three different roles. But enough about me for the moment. We have a tremendous, tremendous program tonight of three amazing honorees, each of whom, throughout lengthy careers, stood united around a shared mission of promoting a greater America for all of us, especially for the large and growing Latino community. As many of you know, MALDEF opened its doors in 1968, some 56 years ago, in San Antonio, Texas, and simultaneously in Los Angeles, California, after our founders created a legal organization very much modeled on the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, to promote the civil rights of all Latinos living in the United States. Today, MALDEF is known as the Latino legal voice for civil rights in America. For our 56-year existence, MALDEF has worked in the courts, in the halls of Congress, and state and local legislatures, and through the community to create new laws and policies with wide-ranging positive impact for the Latino community and for our nation as a whole. MALDEF works to secure the right to a meaningful vote, to equal educational opportunity, to a non-discriminatory workplace, and for fairness and justice in every endeavor across the country. Our history includes the momentous 1982 Supreme Court victory in Plyler versus Doe, whose 42nd anniversary is this very week. Plyler, as many of you know, guaranteed the right to a free kindergarten through 12th grade public education for all children nationwide, regardless of immigration status. A victory that decades later is the foundation for ongoing efforts throughout the nation to provide citizenship not just to dreamers, but to the millions of others who contribute daily to the progress of our nation without full protection of the law. Tonight, we honor three individuals who have made immeasurable contributions to society and are unified by a commitment to the principles of equality and fairness for all. Principles embodied in our Constitution, but too often, historically, honored in their violation more than in their fulfillment. I want to note that we have been in Chicago since 1980, and our office continues to make tremendous contributions to the Midwest, not just in Chicagoland, but throughout the Midwest, bringing litigation, pursuing legislation, and community education to serve our mission of promoting the civil rights of all Latinos living in the United States. Tonight, I want to recognize that since we last met a year ago, our then regional counsel for our Midwest office has transitioned to being a circuit judge. By my count, she is the fourth MALDEF Regional Counsel from the Chicago office to serve in the federal or state judiciary. And by my calculation, that's fully more than half the regional counsels in MALDEF's Chicago office history. That work after MALDEF is a tremendous example of how much our organization and its MALDEFians, because we have a saying, once a MALDEFian, always a MALDEFian, whether you're wearing a judicial robe or not. One of our honorees tonight is one of those four who transitioned from MALDEF leadership in the Chicago office to the judiciary, and we'll hear more about her later. But I do want to start by asking Griselda Vega Samuel, our recent former Chicago Regional Counsel, to stand and accept our congratulations on her recent appointment to the judiciary. Now, all of our leaders in Chicago, when they leave MALDEF, whether they go to the judiciary or some other leadership position, they leave a hole, of course, in what MALDEF does in the Midwest. But I assure you that even after Griselda's transition to the judiciary, our work in the office continues at a high pace and a high level of impact in Chicago. So I would also like the current staff of MALDEF Chicago office to stand as I read their names and accept our gratitude for picking up the leadership when Griselda left to pursue the judgeship and continuing the important work that the office continues to pursue. Our staff attorneys, Olivia Alden, Martin Klein, Susana Sandoval Vargas, and our equally important staff, Irene Padilla and Angel Rosales. Are they standing? Good. Now, to start the evening off, I now have the great pleasure of introducing MALDEF's first esteemed honoree for the evening, the president and CEO of Instituto del Progreso Latino, Karina Ayala Bermejo. She is, I now know, the very popular recipient of MALDEF's Excellence in Community Service Award tonight. Karina Ayala Bermejo was born in Jalisco, Mexico, and immigrated with her family to Chicago, where she grew up. She earned her undergraduate degree at Loyola University, Chicago, and in 1998, she graduated from DePaul University College of Law with her Juris Doctor degree. Karina started her career at the Chicago Board of Education, where she advanced to the important position of general counsel. Karina has dedicated her career to helping others reach their full potential. She has not only become a beacon to the Latino community, but a respected leader in the Chicago legal community. She has been in the leadership of legal organizations like the Legal Aid Society of Metropolitan Family Services, the Hispanic Lawyers Association of Illinois, and the HNBA, the Hispanic National Bar Association. It was with HLAI that she continued her mission of helping others by creating the highly successful JD Mentoring Program, which pairs Latino college students and law students with Latino lawyers to offer valuable mentoring services to the future lawyer leaders of tomorrow. Karina has been able to do even more to serve the Latino community as the current president and CEO of Instituto del Progreso Latino. As an organization, Instituto is dedicated to progressing the education of the Latino community by creating and providing innovative programs that remove barriers and provide tools to succeed. These programs address adult and secondary education, ESL education, as well as providing educational and legal resources to people on their journey to citizenship. Under her leadership, Instituto was able to launch their College of Nursing, which joined their previously established charter high schools. The first five cohorts of Instituto's College of Nursing have graduated, and 100% of them have successfully become registered nurses. Tangible proof of Instituto's belief that education is power. Thanks to Karina's dedication to community support, Instituto has worked tirelessly to provide more, and at the outset of the pandemic, they partnered with organizations like the Greater Chicago Food Depository and the Illinois Partners for Human Services in order to distribute much-needed food and protective masks to thousands of individuals. This was in addition to Instituto's efforts to increase vaccination rates in the Latino community. Not only has Karina been instrumental in providing life-changing material, legal, and educational support to the Latino community, she also strongly believes in providing joy. Under her leadership, Instituto was able to distribute 3,000 toys to children during the holidays. Her tireless efforts have made a significant and positive impact, which is felt now and will be felt in years and decades to come. Please take a look at the video profile MALDEF created for our honoree, Karina Ayala Bermejo.
Karina is unstoppable. There really isn't any challenge or obstacle that could be in front of her that she can't overcome. And just, you know, given her personal history, her professional history, and every role she's filled, whether it was with the City of Chicago or Metropolitan Family Services or her current role at Instituto, she's just somebody who is not afraid to take risks and not somebody who's afraid to speak her mind. She's just a fearless leader.
So what has driven Karina throughout her life and her career is really, I believe, her family. She has three wonderful kids, and I think her family has ultimately been her driving force.
During Karina's career, she has been actively involved with bar associations, not only the Hispanic Bar Association, but the Chicago Bar Association, and supporting her fellow attorneys and supporting communities again through the charitable work that the organizations do. She has been involved with city government and ensuring that people who are needy get the services that they need. And she's been involved with nonprofit organizations, a number of them actually, that are providing the kinds of services that are needed in our city.
Karina is a remarkably accomplished professional and has also served at the highest levels of government in the City of Chicago. Most important accomplishments, however, relate to her impact on people. She has had a positive impact on the lives of thousands through her work at Instituto, through her work at Family Services, through her work in legal aid.
I have learned so much from Karina, watching her, working with her, and now being a friend of hers. I go back to that care, kindness, and compassion she has for everyone she meets, for everyone she is working with. I learned so much from that, kind of the unconditional love and respect that she has for people. Also, her ability to just listen, to be open, to get to know people, to really know them at a deep level, which also helps her be a very effective leader. The last thing I would say is what I've learned from Karina is about her relentless optimism. The work that she does doesn't always give rewards. It doesn't always measure in palpable success, and sometimes there's actually retrenchment. But she keeps so optimistic about the possibility for change in our society, change in people, and change in the structures that keep people down. And I have learned so much from that in keeping up that optimism as well.
To me, Karina epitomizes what I believe is the legacy of the women of DePaul. Both she and Pat Mendoza, are very intelligent, beautiful women who are committed to their profession as well as to their community. Karina has a deep faith, and I think that that's part of what drives her. She also has a deep commitment to not only her family, but to other families, to ensuring that people have what they need to survive.
She is such an accomplished person, not just as a lawyer, but as a community leader and as CEO and president of one of the most well-respected institutions in the city. She is really unique in the sense that as a leader, she functions with the left and right hand, right side of the brain. And what I mean by that is she's very smart. She can put her lawyer hat on. She can problem solve. She, you know, can think quickly on her feet. But she also has this creative and innovative side, which I think also makes her an amazing leader and manager because she's very empathetic and compassionate. But that said, she's not afraid to make difficult decisions. You know, I think her sense, her deep commitment to social justice, to civil rights, to providing a voice to those who are voiceless, to communities that are underserved, I really think that that's what drives her, and to see how she can make the world a better place, which I think she has in many different ways.
Wow. What an inspiring and ongoing career. Join me in congratulating Karina Ayala Bermejo.
No me quedan las palabras. Ese video es algo que para mi vida lo voy a tener. Wow. I am speechless. That rarely happens. In a room filled with family and friends. No friends. Pura familia aquí. My comments will be adjusted because I am so moved by the honor that is MALDEF on the heels of the 42nd anniversary of Plyler, on what will be the 12th anniversary of DACA, this moment in time that you are creating for me, for us, for the universe is so special. So I'm going to speak a little bit from the heart. The honor of being honored with Pat, who is my mentor, who is a mentor to so many, is really the chef's kiss to this perfect night. And let me correct. And to then see Consuelo Bedoya right here, who was her mentor and a mentor to me, is just this chain of life that is so interestingly and intricately connected to all of us. And then to, on top of that, to have the honor of sharing this with my family on this side here. My father and mother and children and husband and sisters are here today, so that to me, para mí, este reconocimiento es para ustedes. Again, I don't know where to begin because you've said it all, but allow me to make this statement. To protest against injustice is the foundation of American democracy. This is a call to action like no other. We must dissent from the indifference, as Thurgood Marshall said. We must dissent from the apathy. We must dissent from the fear, the hatred and the mistrust. We must dissent from a nation that has buried its head in the sand, waiting for, in vain, for the needs of its poor, its elderly, and sick to disappear and just blow away. We must dissent from a government that has left its young without jobs, education, and hope. And most importantly, we must dissent from the poverty of vision and the absence of moral leadership. I read this on a daily. It is my mission in life to ensure that the struggles of MALDEF, the struggles of our parents, are not in vain.
And as lawyers, we are part of a really noble and privileged profession. None of us are ever here alone. This room is part of the reason why I'm successful, part of the reason why we continue to do what we do, although not easy. It is because of this table here and tables over there. And I stand on the shoulders of so many mentors of which I've mentioned. Thank you, MALDEF. I will never forget this moment. It is so critical, the work that you do, but none more important than now, as the efforts of civil rights laws are being weaponized against the progress that we've made, and specific attacks on Latino organizations like ours, attacks on DACA. Just this morning, I was at a roundtable with the USCIS director, reminding how important it is not to forget about those 800,000 individuals and also those 11 million individuals who are waiting for a pathway to citizenship. Those who know me well know my story as a once undocumented child with brave parents who were migrant farm workers, and that the laws that existed at the time allowed for us, because of a U.S.-born child, to adjust our status. Wow, I won that policy lottery, and I owe it to this country and those who have not to continue to fight. You know that I hold the mission of Instituto very dearly. It is not a career. It is not a job. It's a passion. It's a dedication. We must ensure that all our brothers and sisters reach their full potential. And we, Instituto, we do that through education, training, employment, and legal services. I'm so proud of the work that we do, and I accept this award on behalf of Instituto, the nearly 18,000 participants we serve, and our board chair, Raina Goodman, who's here with me today, and the 230 dedicated Instituto team members. I humbly accept this award. Help me acknowledge Carlos Jaramillo, our COO, Dr. Lau from our College of Nursing, and my assistant, Vivi Gonzalez. I could not do any of this without you. I'm immensely proud of the work that we have done together, and you've seen the highlight. I just wanted to close, because I would be a horrible daughter if I didn't, give a message to my parents in Espanol, si me dejan. Mami, papi, no me vean. Quiero tomar este momento para agradecer todo lo que hicieron por nosotros y nuestra familia. Mami, feliz cumpleaños. Este reconocimiento. Oh, bravo. That's the OG queen. Este reconocimiento es el resultado de tus esfuerzos. Y me han llevado a este momento de éxito porque todos los sacrificios que hicieron. Sin su apoyo y sacrificios, por seguro, no hubiera sido posible. A pesar de todas las dificultades, siempre estuvieron a nuestro lado, guiándonos en el camino. A mis hermanas Marielva, Esmeralda, Anobo, Enía, no se pueden imaginar lo importante que están aquí, y los quiero mucho. Shifting to English. Liam, Elijah, Abby Rose, you are my heart that lives outside my body. You are brilliant. You are beautiful human beings to whom much is given, much is expected. And I know you know that. to my best friend and partner in life, everybody knows Frankie. Everybody loves Frankie. He is pure joy and love. The universe put us together since I was 16 years old, and that is my biggest blessing. Thank you so much.
It is now my great honor and pleasure to introduce MALDEF's next honoree this evening, someone whom I had the great honor and privilege of working with at MALDEF, and who I am tremendously envious of because she is less than a month from retirement. But of course, those who know the honoree no, it's not really retirement. It's what others have called rewirement, because she will continue to be doing incredibly important work for the community. Our next honoree this evening is, of course, the Honorable Patricia Mendoza, Associate Judge for the Circuit Court of Cook County. And tonight's recipient of MALDEF's Lifetime Achievement Excellence in Government Service Award. Patricia Mendoza grew up in Chicago's working-class neighborhoods as the only daughter of Mexican immigrants. Her father came to the U.S. thanks to the Racero program, and her mother joined him shortly thereafter. From a very young age, Patricia was exposed to the struggles faced by the Latino community firsthand. Her mother, who had received a college education herself, impressed the incredible importance of education onto her daughter. It was thanks to her mother's influence and the influence of her mentor, Consuela Bedoya Witt, that Patricia graduated from DePaul University College of Law in 1984. After receiving her law degree, Patricia became a staff attorney at the Legal Assistance Foundation of Chicago. She continued her work in civil rights litigation with the American Civil Liberties Union and the Chicago Board of Education. It was in 1995 that Patricia became a part of the MALDEF family forever, serving as the regional counsel for MALDEF's Midwest region here in Chicago. During this time, she was fiercely dedicated to her work as regional counsel. It was thanks to her experience in protecting the Latino community, people just like her parents, that MALDEF was able to address issues facing Latinos nationally throughout the Midwest region. When it was time for her to move on, it was Consuelo once again who pushed her to become a judge. Patricia initially spent some time with the Office of the Illinois Attorney General as Chief of the Civil Rights Bureau before she was appointed to the bench in 2005. Now, as a judge in the Circuit Court of Cook County, Judge Mendoza has been able to do even more to serve her community by providing everyone who comes before her with the dignity and respect that they each deserve. Her judicial assignments have included the Domestic Violence Court and the Juvenile Justice Division. Judge Mendoza has served our community in so many ways as a lawyer and as a judge, and she has been a tireless advocate throughout her career for the Latino community. Please join me in taking a look at the video MALDEF has produced to pay tribute to Judge Patricia Mendoza's incredible work.
Well, I can tell you that from the moment I met Patricia Mendoza, she has been a proactive person. She's proactive about what she sought in her career, and I have had the great privilege of working side by side with her in some very difficult situations. And I can tell you that she is somebody who, once she makes up her mind to do something, she gets it done.
One of Pat's biggest accomplishments, I would say, is her impact on attorneys, particularly newer attorneys to the profession, and just her interaction, her mentoring and encouragement. The other impact Pat has made is in doing justice, where some individuals might immediately and initially go for the hammer. Pat went for the scales to balance out the interests, yes, the law, but also the interests of the person, and not that person as a number, but that person as an individual and a part of our community. And also assessing what could she do in her contact with that person to leave that person in a better place and make that person a more productive member of the community.
She's someone who's extremely committed to community, to making a difference. She's a role model It means that you give back in whatever way you can. She has done that with what she does on the bench. I know there have been times that she has sentenced youth, but she has written to them and saying, here's a book, you know, start reading it. You know, she'll check in on some of them. That to me is going the extra step. It's not a job, it is a commitment to a way of life.
The word that comes to mind is resilience. She has faced very difficult times in her life, and she has taken all of them as a challenge. And by challenging herself to overcome the obstacles, her resilience has grown tenfold. Not only has she excelled as a jurist, but she excels as a runner. She's fluent in French. Physical problems that she has had, she has overcome in such a graceful manner.
I think every day she came in to work knowing that decisions that she made would affect the outcome set of people's lives, and she took that role very seriously. She wasn't cavalier about the power that she had. And she made her choices in a measured, respectful way. It's her sense of decency. It's the way that she treats people. You know, Judge Mendoza, she grew up in Chicago in a working class environment where, you know, it's not a privileged environment at all. I think even now, when she's a person of privilege, she has a good income, she has a good job, she hasn't lost her identity with people who are struggling. And I think that imbues how she works as a judge. She identifies with people in the community and the clients, and she understands the struggle that they face.
As a judge, because she's been a judge for a long, long time, I think that she has shown other judges the importance of having heart and care in your decisions. She was an incredible advocate, and she took on the difficult cases. And the other thing is, she was very strategic and open to what are the issues that we should be addressing. Because I think that in leadership, sometimes we just take the issues that are kind of out there and easy to spot. They don't look for issues. She went out looking for what is beneath the surface that we need to work on. I think that Judge Mendoza's legacy is twofold, right? One as a judge, because I think that as a judge, she has really shown heart, and she's treated the people before her with kindness and with interest, and advocated for them in her courtroom. And that is a legacy that any other judge should emulate. And the other one as a civil rights leader and as an attorney, because she worked very hard. I saw her work, I worked with her side by side, and I saw the interest, the concern, and the impetus for making the Mexican-American experience in the U.S. better and our lives as a community better.
Please join me in welcoming to the stage and honoring the Honorable Patricia Mendoza.
Woo, that's very unfair. They don't let us see this video ahead of time. So let's throw them off their game, show them something to make them cry, and then come up here and make some statements. So I am so humbled and honored, and quite frankly, a bit sheepish about this award. It doesn't seem right to be acknowledged for having had the privilege of doing something that I have truly enjoyed. Nevertheless, I'm grateful because it gives me the opportunity to acknowledge and honor the many people who, upon whose shoulders I stand. Sometimes someone sees something in you that you don't see in yourself, and it changes the trajectory of your life. And for me, that person was the Honorable Judge Consuelo Bedoya. I was a shy, tongue-tied 19-year-old when I first met her, and she plucked me out of my back-of-the-yards neighborhood and offered me a job in her legal office downtown. She was relentless in her encouragement that I go to law school. Before she suggested it, the idea had never even occurred to me. It was ridiculous. I couldn't even maintain eye contact with strangers. But she persisted, and finally she wore me down. And in 1984, I received my law degree from DePaul University College of Law. And I must say, clearly, DePaul produces some great attorneys, because Karina is an alumni as well. But Consuelo went on to become the first Latina judge in Illinois. And although our contact became less frequent over the years, she wasn't done with me. If you know Consuelo, you understand what I mean. About 16 years into my legal career, she reached out and encouraged me to become a judge. And we performed the same dance. The idea of a judgeship had never occurred to me. I couldn't envision it. I resisted. She persisted. And of course, she got her way. And in 2005, I became a judge. And I have had a rich and fulfilling legal career thanks to Consuelo's unrelenting belief in me. But despite Consuelo's belief in me, my belief in myself during my first year of law school wavered. And I might very well have dropped out if it had not been for DePaul's small but mighty Latino lawyer alumni group. There was Virginia Martinez, the first Latina to become a lawyer in Illinois. Justice David Cerda, the first Latino to become first a judge, a circuit court judge, and later an appellate court judge in Illinois. Viola Rouse, Dolores Quiros, Sandra Castillo, Jim Rosas, John DeLeon, Judge Greg Vasquez. They were a constant presence at the school and ensured that we felt supported in the uncertain and at times isolating law school environment. But before Consuelo and the DePaul Latino alumni, there were my parents, Antonio and Celia Mendoza. And unfortunately, unlike Karina, and Karina, you're very lucky to have your parents here today. And felicidades, padres de Karina. Deben de ser muy orgullosos de ella. My parents passed away. But if I've done anything deserving of this recognition, it is because of the lessons I learned at home. Lessons given not more by action than by word. Like many immigrants, my parents came to this country with nothing. And through hard work, they built a life. And their goal was to give me a better one. My mom especially was determined that I was to become somebody. And with Consuelo's help, that dream came true. But the first time my mom visited me in my neighborhood legal services office, she was a little bit perplexed. She'd seen Consuelo's office, after all. And she asked me why I wasn't in one of those nice downtown offices with matching furniture and nice artwork. And when I replied, because I want to help people, my mom lost it. She said, "Yo no sé de dónde coges esas ideas de ayudar a la gente." Said, "Todos ven por sí mismo y solo tú quieres ver por los demás." I don't know where you get those ideas about helping people. Everyone else looks out for themselves and only you want to look out for others. And I responded, "Gosh, Mom, you're right. I don't know where I get these ideas. Just because ever since I can remember, there have been strangers living in our house because they have nowhere else to go." And when I confronted my mom with the fact that she and my dad were responsible for this notion of helping people, she very humbly replied,
pues hacíamos lo que podíamos y no podíamos hacer más. We did what we could and we couldn't do more. And I responded, well, wouldn't you expect at least as much from me? Before I end these remarks, I want to address the Latino lawyers in this room. You are role models for those coming after you. You are proof that barriers can be shattered and that Latino lawyers can survive and thrive in law firms, corporations, government, academia, and the judiciary. I honor you and I respect you. We all have roles to play in advancing our community, and while mine might have been in the public sector, we need Latino lawyers in all sectors, opening doors and reaching back. You are your parents' greatest dream come true. On a personal note, my greatest dreams are here today, and I am very blessed. My children, Philip and Annalisa, and my new daughter, Gabby. I am so very proud to share this moment with you. And lastly, my husband, who jokingly said, don't forget to thank me. But he's probably dying because he didn't mean it. But in truth, to be able to do what I've done, I needed to have his support. And he has never questioned any of my crazy ideas, any things that I wanted to support during the, well, there is still a migrant crisis, obviously, but I was collecting clothes and suddenly there were bags and bags and bags and bags of clothes in the house. And I'm not going to say he was okay with it, but he supported it. So I want to thank him as well. I want to congratulate Karina. I follow you. I mean, obviously we're friends, but I also see everything that you do on Facebook, and I honestly don't know how you do it. You have raised three incredible children. You have suffered some challenges. You have done so much, and I honor you and respect you for that. Finally, there's a Timberland ad quote that I came across a number of years ago, and while I'm still not sure what it has to do with boots, I think there is an important message. And it reads as follows. When we look at a statue of someone great, we think that they've got something we don't. We are trained to think that only a tiny percentage of us have the stuff it takes to be a hero, a king, or a queen in someone's life. Not many of us will cure any diseases or slay any dragons, but every single one of us is called to be a king, a queen, or a hero in our ordinary lives. We don't build statues to worship the exceptional life. We build them to remind us of what's possible in our own. My lifetime achievements were made possible because of the people who came before me, people who made personal sacrifices and suffered untold indignities, people who were working for a better life for everyone. I hope that my life's work of advocating injustice makes them proud, and equally important, has made a difference in the lives of the people that I have had the privilege of serving. Thank you again for your attention, and thank you, MALDEF, for this wonderful recognition.
Thank you and congratulations, Pat, Honorable Patricia Mendoza, for all that you have done, and I know what you will even in your retirement do on behalf of the Latino community. It is now time for our final honoree of the night. This recognition comes too late for the individual being honored, but to use the legal terminology, there is no statute of limitations on recognizing those who have confronted searing injustice with dignity, strength, and resilience. Therefore, our final award tonight goes to Sixto Diaz Rodriguez, known professionally as Rodriguez. He is the now world-renowned singer and songwriter and the posthumous recipient of MALDEF's Lifetime Achievement Excellence in the Arts Award. Sixto Díaz Rodríguez, professionally known as Rodríguez, born in 1942, was the sixth child in his family of working class Mexican immigrants. He was born in Detroit, Michigan, and grew up in the historic Woodbridge neighborhood. Knowing firsthand the intense alienation faced by Latino immigrants, this marginalization from society fueled his artistic process and ultimately led to him becoming an internationally known singer and songwriter. That success came much later in life, as his career did not launch as it could have. Rodríguez faced stonewalling obstacles from music executives and radio disc jockeys. In the early 70s, he released two albums that, because of this circumstance, sold unfortunately poorly in the United States. He was dropped from his music label before being able to finish his third album. He officially ended his music career due to the discrimination-inspired alienation that he suffered. But his drive to advocate for justice in his community did not leave him. Rodríguez graduated from Wayne State University and ran several times for office to help. Although his efforts were not fruitful in getting elected, he instilled in his daughters, from that action, a deep commitment to advocating for social justice. Unbeknownst to Rodríguez himself, at the same time, he was steadily gaining a growing global audience with his albums. He was hugely popular across New Zealand, Australia, Zimbabwe, Botswana, and South Africa. The political nature of his work became immensely popular during a time of social upheaval, especially in South Africa. However, his global fans had at the time no idea who he was. It was thanks to the advent of the internet and a global search that Rodríguez and his fans were eventually able to connect. This discovery led to the revival of his music career in the 1990s. He was finally recognized in the United States when the documentary film Searching for Sugar Man opened at the Sundance Film Festival to much acclaim and was released broadly in 2012. The documentary about his life story won a BAFTA award in 2013 and an Oscar at the 85th Academy Awards. Rodríguez spent the following year receiving his long-denied acclaim and touring the United States and Europe. He was featured on 60 Minutes with singers Adele and Taylor Swift and performed on the David Letterman Show. He embarked on his final North American tour in the latter half of 2019, even as his health was deteriorating. Rodríguez died at the age of 81. In the end, he was heralded, justly, as a voice that inspired a young generation of South Africans to stand up against apartheid. He left behind his wife and his three daughters. We are pleased this evening to welcome two of them who are with us in person, Sandra Rodríguez Kennedy and Reagan Rodríguez Barashka. Please join me. Please join me in watching the video MALDEF created as a tribute to our honoree, Rodríguez.
Our next guest, I don't even know where to begin to tell you. First of all, if you're near this movie, Searching for Sugar Man, go see it. It's jaw-droppingly fascinating. And the man is here tonight. The music is incredible. He's a talented singer-songwriter, and he's the subject of a fascinating film that I mentioned, Searching for Sugar Man. And his music is also featured on the film soundtrack. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rodriguez.
The smile was my first impression. And I had seen the documentary, so he was smiling a lot in the documentary, but that's for a documentary, you know. And it was the smile, his manner, his welcoming spirit. You really felt like, you know, you're in a backstage, you know, at this hall and at the hotel talking. There's people around. I mean, he, you know, the fervor around him at the time was pretty incredible. And yet you felt like he was talking to you, like he was interested in you and wanting to know about you. And the other impression I got was how thankful and grateful he seemed and was, but it seems to me that there could be, with what he's gone through in his life, both good and bad, there could be a bitterness, there could be a what if, there could be regret, there could be what we all experience. And there wasn't that in him. He was grateful, even though he had been taken advantage of for a long time and wasn't able to enjoy in a lot of the success that he didn't even know was happening around the world. He was content. It seemed refreshing to me.
Well, I heard most about Rodriguez. Certainly his musical skits, they were pretty amazing and unique. But again, you go back to somebody who really wasn't caught up in any of the hoopla around him. He was just happy he was recognized. And, you know, he was just a true to the bones poet. You know, he, when he talked about something, he's political. He's very political, but he talked about it in a way that wasn't a way that was going to be negative. It was a way to make it positive. You know, he looked after his family. And, I mean, he didn't take any money. You know, they generated box office because they had one daughter who was in charge of Australia, one in charge of Africa, and one in charge of the United States, and he was on tour quite a bit. You know, I saw him once in Switzerland, and he was playing in Zurich. Bus pulled up, played two shows, got on the bus to go play somewhere in Austria the next night. So, you know, he was doing it because that's what the family wanted to do.
Rodriguez did so much for those around him, but if I have to think of the thing that might be the most profound was just really the fact that he genuinely did not see any value in accumulating wealth himself, and he used his success to help all of those around him, whether it was family or friends or any person that he found was in need, he would want to help them. So even though he could have died very wealthy, he did not, and I think that speaks volumes to his character. He was really using his success and fame and everything to really bring up those around him to help the poor, to help the people that needed money. He really lived by it. He wasn't just simply saying so. And I think that is profound. That is, he used to, in his own words, as far as I understand, he used to say, he's investing in people. So investing in people is what he called it. Everyone else would be calling it giving money away. But that's how he saw it, and that's what he stood for. He was the most generous person, and he always wanted to use, as soon as money would come in from royalties or shows, he would immediately be looking for who needs this money. And that is not how the rest of the world thinks. But Rodriguez was unbelievable.
What I learned from Rodriguez was just being able to see somebody who was so much true to themselves. You know, he lived in the same place. You know, he was, you know, courteous to everybody. He looked after his family. His music was really important. If you saw things in the movie where, you know, you felt he should really be mad at some of the people that maybe took his things, he didn't have that feeling you might see in another musician. He wasn't happy, but it was like, you know, that's the way it went. And he was living his life in a way that, you know, wasn't going to be compromised for anybody.
He saw people for what they were. I guess Dylan and a lot of others like Dylan did as well. Sixto Rodriguez is one of the most fabulous people that I've ever met, and I've met a lot of them. I knew Jimmy Dean, I knew Presley, Marilyn Monroe. I've known some very, very important people. They're icons today. Rodriguez is the top of the list, and I admire a person that lived in a house with no electricity at the time, and 40 years, maybe longer, and didn't go out and when he got successful with a film, go out and buy all these goodies. He didn't do that. Gave his money to people that needed it. Wonderful. Wonderful man. Wonderful human being. This is my favorite artist of all time, and I've worked with a lot of them.
The two things that struck me the most about Rodriguez were that he, even after all he went through and everything he missed out on, potentially, even though I don't think he'd say that, or he would have said that, is that he was really grateful for when it happened, where he was at that moment, being able to bring his music to people without being bitter or angry or regretful or thinking, I missed, 30 years of being able to make music for a living and not having to break my back. I would probably feel that way. I know a lot of people I know would feel that way. And he talked about I remember in an interview, he talked about hate or anger as being such a pervasive emotion that it really, those things occupy your whole body, and he didn't want to feel that way. And that's a biggie, because a lot of people use that as motivation, but I think if you use that as motivation, that can work as motivation, revenge, or but I think it can consume you and turn you into a different person. And so I was really struck by that in him, that he was just grateful and really thankful to be able to do what he did. Even though.
Ladies and gentlemen, in our community, we know in the past, in the present, and in the future, especially given the current assaults on our history, we have a responsibility to reclaim the community's history. Please join me in thanking Rodriguez's daughter and welcoming her to the stage to accept the award on his behalf, Sandra Rodriguez Kennedy.
Thank you, MALDEF. My name is Sandra Rodriguez Kennedy. It's an honor, a privilege, and a pleasure to be here. I'm from Detroit, which is relatively downtrodden. So I'd like to tell you guys how proud I am of all your successes and everything that you've accomplished and your passion for justice, civil rights, decency. So keep doing what you're doing. Rodriguez was cut from that same cloth, not on our watch. Would there be civil rights violated? We'd speak up for ourselves, we'd use our amendments, we'd use our rights, we'd use our voice. Sometimes things need to be said. If injustice happens in your presence, it's your responsibility to speak up, to extinguish it, or else you're just as guilty. Mexican peoples, Rodriguez was proud of his Mexican heritage. Whenever he would do an interview, he would say, both my mother and father were both Mexican. My grandmother was from Maria del Rios, and my grandfather was from San Luis Potosí. I visited there, and I wrote 10 speeches, and I'm not using any of them, but I'm gonna talk to you guys because Rodriguez gave me the freedom. He let me know that I do belong, and that was reiterated by President Thomas Sines. I thank you so much. I belong here. I'm worthy, I'm capable, and I'm gonna take my place at the table if I gotta bring my own chair. So I'd like to start by saying thank you. I can't say thank you, and my gratitude runs deep to MALDEF for selecting Rodriguez to receive this prestigious Lifetime Achievement Award. I'd like to thank Jessica Barahona. Jessica, she helped us get here, and I'd like to thank Gina Montoya. She's the one that, you know, knew about my dad and knew that he was somebody special. And whatever the rarest animal is in the world, Rodriguez is right up there with that animal. So in addition to that, Gina Montoya, Destiny, Jessica, I'd like to also make mention of the reason for Rodriguez's success was we were at Sundance Film Festival and we showed the film. Sony Classic Pictures was there and they purchased it immediately. After it filmed, it won every award, Audience Choice Award, Best Soundtrack, everything. So they purchases it, and what Rodriguez couldn't do, they did. They distributed it to 58 countries. We did our part. We toured with the documentary. We did 250 shows around the world, and he used that platform to talk politics. He used that platform to bring up the election. He used his own money for campaigns, print signs, and everything. I won't get off topic. Okay. Okay, so thank you, Mel. All right. So this award is super special, but it makes it even more special that it's coming from someone who defends civil rights. And you're everybody and everything we've needed our entire lives. The film hit me in my emotions, and you're entitled to your emotions. I have a thirst and a hunger for justice, just like you guys, for Rodriguez, for every artist. Rodriguez never hesitated to address the struggles and for the working class in Detroit, the Big Four, who utilized Mexican labor force to build those cars. So viva la raza. We also followed with Cesar Chavez. We stopped trains, we closed supermarkets, we let it all rot in the fields. And I always say, F around and find out, and they found out. And it was there that I knew the power in numbers. It was there that I knew we had rights and we had a responsibility to uphold our dignity and also to speak up and revolt if need be. Rodriguez would say it's better to live on your feet than spend your life on your knees. So. Oh, to die on your feet than to live on your knees. It's better to die on your feet than to live on your knees. Musicians, soldiers, activists, protesters, they They embraced Rodriguez's music. It spoke to their plight. They used it in their demonstrations. He spoke on the things that we experience every day. Discrimination. It's not only wrong, it's illegal. Tell him, sister. Thank you. There's so much more I'd like to say. The thing about Rodriguez music is there was a conflict going on in Namibia, and both sides of the conflict were listening to Rodriguez. It's powerful political music. He considered himself a musical political. Use your art to tell the story and make your point. And thank you very much. I think I'm done here. And it's never too late or never too early.
Thank you. Thank you for your inspiring words on behalf of your father. And thank you for allowing us to celebrate his resilience in the face of searing injustice. So we have come to the end of another inspiring Chicago Gala. It's this time that I first begin by thanking those who helped to put together tonight's event and help MALDEF in its endeavors. Traditionally, I start with thanking the MC, so let me thank Jorge Ramos, Anderson Cooper, Slash, Anthony Fauci. We have two, one current, one former MALDEF board member in the room, and I want to recognize them, but also recognize all of the board members throughout our 56-year history, starting with the founders, most of whom have now passed on, and continuing to today. So let me ask Elizabeth Lopez, current board member, and former board member Carlos Montoya to stand up on behalf of all of the board members from MALDEF beginning to today. And of course, none of the work could be done without a dedicated, sacrificing staff across the country who, at salaries that are regrettably much lower than what they could earn in different legal settings. And that extends not just to the lawyers, but to all of our staff who accept lower salaries because of their dedication to the mission that we pursue. So let me ask all of our past and present MALDEF staff members to please stand and accept our thanks for the work that you have done and continue to do. So putting together an event like this is, of course, not easy. So let me thank all of those who contributed to setting up this extraordinary gala dinner. Gina Montoya, Sandra Hernandez, Julie Gallego, Jessica Barahona, Destiny Cortez, Jose Delgado, Israel Delgado, and all of the MALDEF Chicago interns. Thank you for all that you did. I count myself very fortunate to have had incredible honorees, and tonight is certainly no exception. Each of them has inspired us not just by their work, not just by the laudatory commentary in the videos, but by their words tonight, inspired us to recognize the ongoing critical struggle for justice for the Latino community. So let me once again thank the incredible, tireless, and dedicated Karina Ayala Bermejo. incredibly wise and committed with a heart, Judge Patricia Mendoza. And of course, the legendary and talented Rodriguez. We got a little election going on this year. I know some of you are aware of that. I know in Chicagoland, you've got a convention related to that election. It's become almost a cliche, at least within the Latino community, if not always recognized by white pundits and others on cable and news media. But it's become almost a cliche that the Latino community, with its size and growth, in election after election, becomes the exception that changes the national outcome. That our participation and always inadequately anticipated impact on the vote changes outcome. You'll see a wave across the country, in the Senate or the House, and then you hit the heavily Latino states, and all of a sudden, the momentum shifts. So that cliche certainly applies truthfully to this election. But others have asserted and will assert with great accuracy that this year it's not about saving the outcome of a single election. This year, the Latino community and allies are called upon to save democracy in the United States. It seems as though we are in a series of the most consequential election, but this year is true. Our democracy, which most of us grew up believing from what we were taught in school, was beyond peer in standing above any threat. We now know that that was mythology, and that our nation, as much as any other, today, around the globe, or in history, can lose its democracy if we do not act to ensure its survival. And in this year, with Latinos as the second largest racial group in the electorate, after whites, the second largest racial group in the electorate, we are called upon to repeat with greater impact what we have accomplished at the ballot box in the past, saving democracy, saving an election. But I will say on behalf of MALDEF, a now 56-year-old civil rights organization whose work, whose mission is grounded in a belief that is the cornerstone of so many other organizations and associations across the country. A deep-seated belief in the rule of law. That is at the core of MALDEF's efforts. Our founders made a decision that instead of creating an organization that would be organizing in the streets, and I mean no diminution of the importance of organizing in the streets. But our founders decided not to create that organization, to march on the courthouses, to march on the elected officials' offices. They made a decision also not to create an electoral advocacy organization that would collect donations, line up votes, work to get out the vote, on behalf of particular candidates. They created an organization, as I mentioned previously, very much consciously founded on the model of the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund that had achieved the monumental victory in Brown versus Board of Education, this year celebrating its 70th anniversary, a decade and a half before MALDEF's founders decided to create a similar organization for the growing Latino community. But as an organization grounded in a belief in the rule of law, whether a C3 nonpartisan organization, as we are, or not, we cannot stand idly by and ignore that the inflection point of our nation is defined by the presence within our midst, nationwide, of convicted insurrectionists and unindicted co-conspirators in the attempted insurrection on January 6th of 2021. We, as believers in the rule of law, cannot ignore that together with those insurrectionists, we have far too many apologists for insurrection in our legislatures, in our Congress, in our Senate. We cannot ignore that we have, from our highest court on down, we have too many judicial facilitators of those insurrectionists and their anti-democratic goals. We know that not only do those judicial facilitators issue rulings by categorizing important topics as beyond the pale of court intervention, as political questions not to be resolved outside of a Congress that is completely incapacitated by its over-partisanization in comparison to its historical predecessors. We know that those judicial facilitators also are engaged in a game to restrict the rights achieved over half a century of civil rights work by the legal defense funds and others throughout our country. We need look no further than a year ago in the decision in the Harvard and University of North Carolina cases to understand the pernicious and broad sweeping aims of those judicial facilitators of insurrectionists. But we also know, not just from that history of election after election after election, of the Latino vote inadequately measured, inadequately feared by some, though we know ultimately that fear of our growth is behind so much of what I am describing. But inadequately assessed, we nonetheless, election after election, have made a difference. And so we know in this room and beyond that it is the Latino community that will make a difference, that has already written in our history, future history as well as present and past. We have already written through our tenacity, our strength, our courage, our resilience, the outcome of this conflict. And while we must work, we know that with the Latino community, a Latino community that, although this is never cited in the mainstream media, a Latino community that has now for over 21 years been the largest racial minority community in the nation. A Latino community that at 19% of the national population already matches the highest proportion of any racial minority group in the entire nearly 250-year history of our country. In other words, Latinos are on the cusp of becoming the largest minority group in the entire history of the United States of America. They don't talk about it because of the fear, unjust fear that it induces in too many. But we know with that strength, with the characteristic traits I described from our history, we know the outcome. And it is nothing more and nothing less than the preservation of democracy for every person of any race in this country. It is the preservation and the extension of justice for every person of any race in this country. It is nothing more or less than the perpetuation and realization for the first time in our nation's history of the central principles of our Constitution, of the Declaration of Independence, of the uniformly held values that draw everyone who comes from around the globe to this country. We know that the Latino community, despite the slander of the great replacement theory, we know that in the end, this year and in the future, the Latino community will be the savior of the United States of America. And at MALDEF, we look forward to working with all of you in this room, beyond this room, in allied communities to ensure that this year and in the future, that predicted history of the future is realized. Thank you all for being here tonight. We look forward to seeing you again next year in the aftermath of an important step to that victory. Have a good evening.